Welcome to Red Wilson Field for an East Division matchup between the Whitey Red Sox and the Chatham Anglers. Brian McLaughlin and TJ Mathewson here. TJ, it looks like we might be able to squeeze this one in, as currently home plate in the pitcher's mound are tarped here at Red Wilson, but it has certainly been a wet week here on Cape Cod. There's been multiple cancellations. We've played one nine-inning game really since last Saturday, the doubleheader on Sunday, but now we're back. Hopefully playing a nine-inning one today against Chatham. We'll wait and see, but it's been a weird week on Cape Cod.
Yeah, we now have 20 cancellations here in the Cape Cod League in the first 12 days of the season. It's just so bizarre. The Red Sox, most of the league has played one game, if that, since Sunday. It's just having one game in one week here, it's backloads the schedule so much with these makeups. Red Sox are playing something like 25 games in a row. That was actually before the cancellation yesterday, that against Bourne at home. Bourne again today, their field not look good over there, as there was a passing thunderstorm that looks like it just missed us. We got sprinkled with a little bit of rain, and there's some thunder and lightning hovering around the area. It's still pretty dark out. I mean, out driving to the ballpark today, it was sunny, no clouds in sight, and then we get here and you look out west and you just see this wall of clouds coming this way. But these two teams are going to be playing here tonight.
We're at least going to get started.
Yeah, we're at least going to start. Yeah.
Looks like it's going to be a good pitching matchup between these two squads. TJ on the mound for YD. It's Ian Seymour from Virginia Tech, and Maisel Hazelwood takes the mound for Chatham from Kentucky. Hazelwood struck out 10 so far this season, 6 when he faced off against these Red Sox last time. And on the other side, Seymour has 9 Ks in just one outing. So some lefty strikeout guys on the mounds today between these two teams.
Yeah, a real treat up on there in the bump. I'm excited to see Seymour pitch. It's been almost a week and a half since Seymour was last out on the bump. Last time we saw him out, as you mentioned, 5 innings, 9 strikeouts, was really spectacular. Was missing a ton of bats against Orleans. Really got the Red Sox up and going this season. And they're going to face a guy, Mason Hazelwood. They really struggled against their last time out. Hazelwood came out of the bullpen when the Red Sox were in Chatham. He ended up getting the win, 3 innings, 6 strikeouts, including an immaculate inning in there where he was just mowing down the Red Sox hitters. Really had a lot of trouble with that Chatham pitching staff that night. Tom Holliday, if you missed it in the first game that YD was at Chatham, Holliday likes to go with the 3-pitcher system, 3 innings each for scheduled guys, and then, you know, maybe sprinkle in another guy in there if they need to. So we'll see Hazelwood today, and we'll see how well these YD hitters adjust, especially now playing at home.
Last time we saw these two squads, we were at Chatham, and we were welcoming Alex Terrell from Miami and Spencer Torkelson from Arizona State. 47 home runs between the two of them coming into the Chatham lineup, but it's been the YD lineup that's impressed so far this season. They lead the Cape League in runs per game, and almost every offensive category at this point. They have been spectacular from top to bottom, so good pitching matchup, but then a whole lot of talent in these lineups as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the Red Sox offense, it's been a shame these games have kept getting pushed back because just preventing us from being able to watch them and keep the bats going. You know, momentum, playing on back-to-back days really helps you get in a groove, and they've had to sit out many days. The one game the Red Sox did play this week over in Orleans, it looked, you know, pretty good. It was really foggy and wet, but the Red Sox went out there against a potential first-round pick next year in Cole Wilcox and just jumped on him right in the first inning. And we saw Noah Campbell blast a 3-run home run as they touched him up. It was really impressive to watch.
Meeting of the minds at the moment behind home plate as we wait to get started. It looks like we're going to get a national anthem coming up, and then hopefully first pitch coming up around 4:45, trying to get us started early. So we're going to see, and we'll be back in a few moments with Red Sox and Anglers baseball here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. back at Red Wilson Field. The Red Sox have taken the field for this matchup against the Chatham Anglers. Brian McLaughlin and TJ Mathewson here trying to bring you some baseball. It's cloudy over Red Wilson. There's been sprinkles on and off really all afternoon, starting around 3 o'clock. But it looks like we're going to give it a go today, TJ. Ian Seymour on the mound, making his second start for the Red Sox. He's 1-0 with a 3.60 ERA and just one start for YD this season. He's a solid lefty that walked only one and struck out 9 against Orleans back in the home opener here, and a really promising start for him on the mound.
Yeah, and he's going to be challenged right off the bat, this Chatham lineup, and we just had a flash of lightning, it looked like, here at Red Wilson Field. But he's going to get challenged here right off the bat. Spencer Torkelson batting in the two-hole, right-handed hitter, one of the toughest guys to get out in all of college baseball. So right off the bat, Seymour is going to have his challenges with his Chatham lineup, which has been really middling in terms of run scoring, but really yet to get those big backs going as well.
Like you said, right in the middle with 34 runs on the season. Here is the Anglers lineup. Caden Polkovich leads off from Oklahoma State. Spencer Torkelson bats second from Arizona State. He's playing left field. Jamal O'Gwin from USC is in the three spot. He leads qualified hitters in batting average in the Cape League at the moment. Brady Smith, the catcher, bats fourth. Alex Terrell is in the five spot, rather. Jonas Ozuna from Oklahoma Wesleyan bats sixth. Ben Ramirez from USC is the shortstop, batting seventh. Cade Cabinas from OK State is batting eighth. And the second baseman, Tyler Dones, bats ninth today for the Anglers. Now for the defense for YD, left to right across the outfield, it's Andrew White. Brad Beasley in center, and the speedy Sam Hall is in right. Riley King makes his debut in the infield for YD at third. Luke Waddell at short. Drew Swift at second, and Tate Samuelson remains at first base. Austin Wells, the Arizona product, is in at catcher with Seymour on the mound today. TJ, this YD defense has been solid through a couple games as the rain starts to come down. Relatively steady now. Some umbrellas go up. Right as Wells fires to second. Timing couldn't be better. Probably the hardest rain we've seen today as Polkovich steps in the leadoff spot.
This weather has just been something these first 2 weeks of the season. I mean, being up here last summer, we saw some rain, but really nothing like this. And it's, of course, as soon as first pitch happens that it starts.
First pitch to the righty Polkovich, a called strike from Seymour, and we're underway and under fire from some rain here at Red Wilson Field. The 0-1 now to Polkovich. Off the plate inside, a ball and a strike. Polkovich hitting 280 on the season. And we're going to have a delay. Home plate umpire today, Rick Emerson, signaling for the Red Sox to clear. Supposed to just be a passing shower. It's scattered throughout the rest of the evening. We wonder if YD will quickly cover home plate in the pitcher's mound, TJ. Just so bizarre, this weather we've had on Cape Cod.
I can't. All day today, it was sunny, not a cloud in the sky. But, of course, as game time rolls around, the rain just comes. It just starts pouring here. It'll probably last another 2 or 3 minutes, and the delay hopefully won't be much longer. But, yeah, I can't fathom it. It's just been so many delays, so many. And it's going to cause these teams, YD, all these teams here on the Cape, to play 25-plus games in a row without a scheduled off day. I mean, that's a lot for the pitchers to take.
And as soon as they get the tarp out on the field, starts to slow down a bit. I think that's just how it's going to be this evening. None of these delays have been the same. We've seen heavy rain. We've seen fog. We've seen mists. Today it's going to be off and on showers all evening long, I believe. And we'll see how that is handled by this YD staff here at Red Wilson Field. Really does, as soon as they get the tarp out there, it's slowing down. The rain out on the playing surface. Going to be looking up at the sky a lot, I think, for Rick Emerson, Scott Pickler. Steve Foucher is the GM here at YD. It's going to be just a guessing game. I know meteorology is the science of weather, but I don't think it's a science today and how the rain's going to come and go.
I got to say, though, the Red Sox and all of us here, Whitey and Chatham, this game did dodge a bullet. You look at the radar earlier, and Wareham, Falmouth, Hyannis, Katuit all got slammed by rain. Bourne especially, too. Whitey just caught the edge of this storm that we're currently in. And, yeah, it's just so frustrating for these teams trying to get in a groove, trying to get going for a Whitey offense and lineup that has been extremely hot, but they haven't been able to get consistent at-bats and consistent look at these pitchers here for the opposition when half, mostly all the games are getting rained out.
And it's one of those deals where if you're the starting pitcher, you can't get warm and get going, as it looks like they might try to clear off the field and get it rolling once again. Rick Emerson pinwheeling his finger as he walks out onto the field as the rain has stopped here at Red Wilson for the time being, TJ. But now Ian Seymour was loose. He'd thrown a couple pitches. He's going to have to throw a couple warm-ups again. On the other side of things, Mason Hazelwood was probably getting warm and is ready to go for the Anglers down in their right field bullpen. So you wonder how that affects him. There's a lot of questions now, especially surrounding the pitching.
Yeah, and, well, these pitchers just going to have to prepare for tonight. Just got to, you know, that's just the kind of night it's been and the kind of week it's been here. Just so much rain. It's been really bizarre. It just seems like forever ago the Red Sox, you know, played, you know, two games in a row. It was on Sunday. Well, they played doubleheader here against Katuit and snagged 3 points out of it.
Seymour retakes the field to a hearty cheer from the bullpen down the left field line for Whitey. He'll begin tossing with Austin Wells. It's currently a 1-1 count to leadoff man for Chatham, Caden Polkovich, their third baseman. Polkovich hitting .280 on the season with a double. He's walked 5 times and struck out 3 times.
And video cameras are permitted inside Red Wilson Field.
And what this rain also does, it scatters all the fans away from the ballpark. We were in Orleans on Thursday, and there was a downpour that cleared out most of the fans there, even though it lasted just about 5 minutes. It was foggy, too, the only game. So it looks like we're going to enter a 30-minute delay here as we're waiting for this weather to pass. Oh, man.
Probably saw some lightning to warrant the 30-minute weather delay. So we'll keep you updated here, fans. TJ, this is frustrating for everybody involved, and us as well as any fans watching. The players just want to play. How Seymour and Hazelwood are going to try to stay loose in this 30-minute delay.
Yeah, one of the biggest things here is going to see how sharp and even how much longer they're going to play. So the 30-minute delay taking place at, I'll say, probably 4:52, so around 5:20 is when we'll get word on if we're going to keep going or have another delay. Another rule there here is that during the lightning delay, if you see more lightning, you restart the clock to 30 minutes.
Restarts at 30, and then the question becomes here at Red Wilson, no lights. If it's cloudy, you know it's going to get dark quicker, even just a day after the summer solstice. You have to imagine it's going to get dark early here with all the cloud cover, and you wonder if you can get 5 innings then in once you start if there's an extensive delay. So certainly a lot of questions here at Red Wilson Field. I know you didn't experience a whole lot of this last year. Did you even have, if you can remember, a couple days in a row with cancellations like this? This is going to be potentially, since Sunday, we had no game Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Somehow squeezed, or rather, no game Monday, Tuesday.
Game.
No official game in any of those days. But then we squeezed Orleans in just a few days ago.
Somehow.
On Thursday. Yesterday we were canceled on Friday, so now this is Saturday. 6th day we have played 1 game, looking to get the 2nd game in 6 days. Was there anything that you can remember even remotely close to this like this last year, TJ?
No, I can't. We did occasionally have a couple straight days of rain, but nothing over the course of a week. And yeah, well, you canceled one I can't remember off the top of my head all the postponements. A couple times trying to go to Bourne, it was a little tricky there with Dorne Park over in Bourne. Sometimes struggles with the drainage on that field, but never a week-long system of weather like this. It's just absolutely bizarre.
Again, 20 cancellations in or postponements or delays over the past 12 days throughout the Cape Cod League, and that's almost done. It really is unheard of in any league, much less the Cape League. In a summer where you're expected to play 44 games throughout the regular season, YD has played 7 in now 2 calendar weeks, and that is pretty crazy considering there was a doubleheader in there as well, counting for 2 games in 1 day. Just hard to fathom anything happening like this, as now the rain has stopped, but we're in the weather delay here at Red Wilson Field. Should be a good one if we can get started between Chatham and YD, TJ. I know we're looking at the offenses as well as big-time pitchers, but how does this affect the batters if you're trying to stay loose in this one, try to continue to see the ball well, and you just can take batting practice all you want, but the scouts are here to watch you hitting games. How does it affect the approaches at the plate?
Well, yeah, I feel like, at least for me, it would be getting a little impatient. You can't see these hitters consistently. You can't see these pitchers. You know, trying to catch up to 90-mile-an-hour fastball is hard enough.
Yeah.
But when you're not in the groove and you're not playing 4, 5, 6 days in a row, it throws you off a little bit. And it will be really interesting to see, especially for a team that was hitting as well as YD was. And it affects the pitchers too. It throws you off your routine. These guys, especially the full-time guys that are here for a summer in the starting rotation, you're pitching once a week. And now for Seymour, he's got to wait now. It's almost 2 whole weeks. Not 2 whole weeks, but about a week and a half since his last start.
And the rotation is just completely thrown out of whack. From it's listed one thing on point streak as YD tries to get the rotation back in order. John Beller probably is just going to have to get pushed back in his spot because he pitched at Chatham when the fog came and ended that start, so he won't get those numbers. And what was a really good start for him, shutting down a powerful Chatham lineup through 3-plus innings on the mound before the fog delay happened, and it's frustrating for him to have his next start pushed back. Seymour, guys like Boyd Vanderkoy have their starts pushed back. Carlos Lamelli has been throwing bullpens. I've seen him down the left field line, it feels like, for the past week, just trying to stay in his throwing routine, and it's hard for everybody involved. Everybody's anxious for baseball, and nobody wants these delays, but it's not like any of these days we've sat here and said, oh, we could have got that one in. It was the right move every single one of these days to cancel.
Well, what was interesting on the Wednesday night game in Chatham, where Whitey and Chatham were fogged out, as soon as Whitey left the field, about 20 minutes later, the fog was gone. There was no more fog at Veterans Field in Chatham. But it would have been interesting to see. I know the rule is after 30 minutes, if the fog hasn't cleared, you got to postpone the game. But that's just the kind of luck that these teams have had this week. And I'm interested to see how the field at Falmouth is going to look tomorrow. They've had some cancellations too at their park, and
that's the area where this big storm really hit
exactly
today. That's the west side of the Cape.
That's what I was thinking of. And Bourne is just what we were talking about earlier. That field was there's puddles everywhere on the infield, and Bourne had to postpone their game today against Hyannis. But Falmouth, too, just a little bit farther south on the Cape. So it's going to be interesting to see how these teams are going to adjust to that. And they're going to be playing a lot of games in a row, I'll tell you that. And we are going to be calling a lot of games in a row.
Hey, they'll love that. We'll love calling the games for you. For the moment, we're going to step aside here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Stay tuned for more updates in the next half hour. Hopefully, we're getting started around 5:20 or so, depending on when they officially say that 30-minute delay went into effect. You'll also be able to stay up to date with all sorts of updates about the weather at our Twitter account, at YD_RedSox. For more updates, TJ and I should be back on in a few minutes, hopefully to bring you more up-to-date news and just continue to talk about this wild summer so far on Cape Cod. We'll be back for more in hopefully about 20 minutes or even sooner here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Back at Red Wilson Field, Ian Seymour back out on the mound for YD. Hopefully I don't have to say that any more times this evening. It is now sunny. Clouds out over center field, but hopefully pushing in the opposite direction. Brian McLaughlin with TJ Mathewson. Hopefully now bringing you some Cape Cod baseball here from Red Wilson Field in Yarmouth. Dennis, we saw two pitches before some rain and lightning came. We're about set to bring us back out of the weather delay. It's currently a 1-1 count to Caden Polkovich with Ian Seymour on the mound. TJ, we only saw two pitches, but should be clear, we hope, scattered thunderstorms and just showers throughout the Cape here on this Saturday evening, but hopefully we get to see some baseball and get five innings in tonight for a complete game.
Yeah, the way it's looking right now, hopefully we'll get nine. I played a nine-inning game, and apart from Thursday's foggy adventure in Orleans, it's been a week on the dot last Saturday.
That's right.
Right, and against the Chatham Anglers.
It was against the Chatham Anglers in a 7-3 Anglers victory over the Red Sox. We saw Mason Hazelwood, who will get the start this evening for the Anglers in that one. He threw in an immaculate inning in there in relief that night for Chatham. He's getting the start this evening for Tom Holliday's squad. Seymour gets the ball from the third baseman, Riley King. Mask on for Rick Emerson behind home plate, and it looks like we're ready to play some baseball. 1-1 count to Caden Polkovich. Anglers in their royal blue uniforms, white numbers, red trim, gray pants with the blue stripe down the side, Red Sox in the home whites, Red Sox across the chest, red piping, red caps for the Red Sox. Here's the 1-1 to Polkovich. Swing and a miss on a changeup from Polkovich, and it's 1-2. Finally got some baseball going. It looks like no rain, so we're going to get more than two pitches this time. Seymour winds the 1-2 pitch. Fastball misses down and into the righty. Two balls, two strikes.
Yeah, Seymour in his first start against Orleans went to the fastball a lot. High fastball to get the strikeout. We'll see what he tries here.
From the windup, the lefty brings the 2-2. Swung on and fouled. First base side. Samuelson gives it a few steps, but it's out of play. Again in the outfield, it's Eister, Beasley, and Hall for the Red Sox. King, Waddell, Swift, and Samuelson on the infield. The Arizona product, Wells, does the catching for Seymour. And the 2-2. Off the plate, high and tight. Seymour thought he had notched the inner edge, and it's run full for the first batter of the game. Now, in between our bit of a delay, just under a half hour, right around a half hour, I would say. Here's the 3-2. In off the hands, off the knob, and back to Seymour, who caught it. How about that? Check swing from Polkovich, hit the actual knob of the bat, never really started the swing, and it, instead of dribbling across the grass, popped in the air to Seymour for the first out here in the top of the first.
That was interesting, to say the least. It looked like a little check swing. It was up and in. I thought it might have got a piece of Polkovich, and instead just takes a nice fly right to Seymour. Barely had to move off the mound.
Now Spencer Torkelson, his first at bat today. First pitch from Seymour inside, and it gets Torkelson on the left hip. Hit by pitch, he'll jog down to first. Seymour was working in a lot to Polkovich, but he plunks Torque for the first base runner for the Anglers. During the delay, TJ, it was Hazelwood throwing off the mound down the right field line for Chatham. There was no rain. Seymour stayed loose by tossing right along the third baseline. Not really throwing or pitching, but letting rip just some regular catch with the teammate along the third baseline. Now one down, Torkelson on first. The batter's Jamal O'Gwin from USC. Seymour from the stretch. First pitch, line drive, soft left field, coming on Eister, and he makes a running grab. Headed towards the line, Eister able to squeeze it for the second out now in the first. A line drive that just hung up from O'Gwin. Two outs now for Brady Smith. Torkelson remains on first. We're scoreless in the top of the first here at Red Wilson Field. Smith, the catcher from Florida, 1-for-4 so far for the Anglers in his brief 2019 summer. The first pitch, fastball misses upstairs, 1-0. The Anglers going with the Royal Blue Bats today throughout their lineup to match the uniforms. Seymour holds the ball below his belt in his glove from the stretch, looks at Torkelson, the 1-0. Fastball upstairs, two balls, no strikes.
Yeah, Seymour's been missing inside a little bit here with all of his pitches, it seems, so far here early. We'll see if he can make that adjustment. Just a hair bit inside, move it back over the plate, just a touch.
That glove side, inside to righties, away to any lefty. The 2-0 to Smith. Grounded, first base side foul. Had some awkward spin from Smith. Landed fair, but twisted into the grass wide of first base for the first strike. Two balls and a strike. Sun is starting to shine a bit here at Red Wilson. Fans starting to filter down either baseline. Long pause from Seymour. Now he kicks and deals the 2-1. Fastball called, strike down the middle. Two balls, two strikes. Outfield straight away for Whitey. Infield maybe playing Smith to pull a hair. The 2-2. Swing and a miss. Got him on the changeup. First strikeout of the day for Seymour. Fan Smith. One man reaches on the hit by pitch, but nothing doing for the Anglers in the first. We're scoreless. Chatham out to the field. Whitey coming up in the bottom of the first when we return on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network.
Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let
bottom
you know
of the
that
first
Shaw's
were scoreless at Red Wilson Field. Whitey to the plate to face Mason Hazelwood, the lefty from Kentucky. He's faced this Red Sox lineup once before. He struck out six exactly a week ago in relief against Whitey. First pitch from Hazelwood to Brad Beasley. This is inside for ball one. Beasley, the outfielder from Cal Poly, 1-for-3 on this young season for YD. Hits from the right side. Here's the 1-0. Fastball misses in. Two balls and no strikes. After Beasley, who's playing center, Luke Waddell at shortstop, Austin Wells bats third doing the catching. Hazelwood working from the windup with the bases clear. The 2-0 pitch. High and away. It's three balls and no strikes to Beasley. After Wells, Tate Samuelson in the cleanup spot. Andrew Eyster from South Carolina bats fifth. Riley King in his debut for YD bats sixth. R.J. Yeager designated hits tonight and bats seventh. Sam Hall eighth and Drew Swift from ASU bats ninth. 3-0. Fastball called strike on the outer edge to Beasley. It's 3-1.
Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors.
Hazelwood brings the 3-1. Beasley lifts it in the air to center. Ozuna going back over to his left into right center and he makes the catch.
Thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star
First
Market.
Out in the
and
bottom of the first on a lineout from Brad Beasley to center field. And that brings up Luke Waddell.
Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe
Castiglione. Defense for Chatham this evening. Spencer Torkelson's in left. Drenis Ozuno just made the first out in center. And Kate Cabanis is in right field. Now Luke Waddell at the plate for YD.
Hi, folks.
First pitch from Hazelwood. Breaking ball off the plate inside for ball one. The infield is made up of Caden Polkovich at third, Ben Ramirez at short, Tyler Dones at second, and Alex Torral at first base. The 1-0. Off speed called strike to Waddell. It's 1-1. Brady Smith does the catching for Hazelwood out of Florida. Now the 1-1.
Where the stars of tomorrow shine.
Fastball
tonight.
Misses away. Two balls and a strike. Similar defensive setting that Chatham used earlier this week in a game that was called due to fall. The 2-1 from Hazelwood. Off the plate away. Three balls and a strike. Second straight batter. He's fallen behind for YD.
Thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market. And to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League.
And the 3-1 to Waddell. Swing and a foul, first base side.
Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here.
Full count, 1-1.
Choosing Shaw's and Star Market. And to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight.
Waddell, 3 for 12 this season for the Red Sox. Here's the 3-2 from Hazelwood. Ground ball back up the middle, past Ramirez and into center field. YD gets their first base runner on a single from Luke Waddell.
Yeah, just a nice piece of it going right back up the middle. And we talk about this YD offense, which is, you mentioned in the open, averaging best in the league, most runs, 49 in 7 games, which is not 7 runs per ball game. Here at home, they've been excellent. They've scored 7 runs, I believe, 7 runs, 8 runs, and 9 runs in their 3 games they've played here at Red Wilson so far in the first 2 weeks.
Now maybe the most impressive hitter through the first week and a half, Austin Wells at the plate. First pitch fastball, this is high and away to Wells, it's 1-0.
And to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's
1-0 count to Wells. Waddell leads from first here in the bottom of the first. Fastball misses off the plate inside to Wells. It's 2 balls and no strikes.
Sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's Red
Wells
Sox
sitting 3-18 on this season. 3 home runs.
Shaw's and Star Market. And to let you know, the
all three coming on last Sunday in a doubleheader against Kitua. Hazelwood sets 2-0 count to Wells. From the stretch, here's the pitch. High and tight to the lefty, 3-0. We're scoreless in the bottom of the first between Chatham and YD, but Mason Hazelwood struggling with some command.
Now, this is where you wonder if this is the delay that might be affecting Hazelwood.
3-0 misses up high, and it's a 4-pitch walk to Austin Wells. He's fallen behind all 3 batters he's faced, and now he walks Wells. So runners on first and second with 1 down for Tate Samuelson.
It might be pitchers also realizing just how well Austin Wells has been swinging the bat, trying to live more on the outer edges and just missing. Wells drew 2 walks against Orleans on Thursday.
Now Samuelson from Cal Poly. He's 2 for 5. First pitch to Samuelson. Downstairs, ball 1.
Hi, folks. It's Red
3 RBIs and a couple of strikeouts for Samuelson in a quick visit out to the mound to talk to Mason Hazelwood. He's thrown 5 straight balls and has fallen behind every single YD Red Sox hitter.
Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's.
We did have about a half hour delay here at Red Wilson Field. You wonder if that affected Mason Hazelwood at all.
Where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight.
Hazelwood from the stretch works from the third base side of the mound. Waddell leads off second, Wells from first, as Hazelwood sets at the chin. A quick turn and look at Waddell at second. Bottom of the first, we're scoreless, Chatham and YD. Tate Samuelson at the plate. 6'2", 205-pound first baseman from Cal Poly. The 1-0. Fastball called, strike to Samuelson, and it's a ball and a strike. Samuelson started 54 games for Cal Poly this year, hit 298. The 1-1. Fastball notches the inner edge for a called strike. It's 1-2 now to Samuelson. This is an Big West honorable mention player as a freshman, just finished his sophomore year. Long look to Waddell at second from Hazelwood. Now the 1-2. Slashed foul over the heads of some fans and out of play down the first baseline. We'll do the 1-2 again. This Whitey offense, the top offense in the league early in this Cape Cod League season. Another 1-2. Samuelson goes down low and fouls it off the Whitey dugout this time, peppering both baselines with foul balls. And we'll see another 1-2. This was something we saw against Orleans as well, against the flamethrower Cole Wilcox, TJ. This Whitey team went to work with two strikes.
Yeah, Wilcox was really struggling to put away those Whitey hitters. We're expecting to see a much better performance from him, but they did a great job.
Another 1-2 is fouled off again by Samuelson. And after striking out so many times against Chatham, this team has all of a sudden really figured it out with two strikes.
Yeah, we talk about the adjustments, and whatever adjustments they did make, it's worked. They've done a really good job with two strikes.
Not that they've played that often, but it seems like an adjustment's been made. Samuelson battling here, down in the count 1-2 against Hazelwood. Here's another pitch. Check swing up high. He did go around. Probably would have been a ball, but Samuelson strikes out on the check swing for the second out here in the first.
The left fielder from the University of South Carolina.
Yeah, just getting a little aggressive there with two strikes. That high fastball always looks so good, but it's very hard to get to at the top shelf of the strike zone, especially with some good velocity on it.
Now runners on first and second, two outs for Andrew Eister. Both teams are scoreless here in the first. Eister, the power-hitting outfielder from South Carolina. Still 8 for 15 on the year for YD. Really started off hot. First pitch. Down low to Eister, ball one. He started 6 for 8 before being 2 for his last 7, so we say he's cooled off. Just doesn't qualify for the league leaders in average, otherwise he would be atop that list. Doesn't have quite enough at-bats per games played. Hazelwood brings the 1-0. Eister lines it left side, jumping catch made by Caden Polkovich at third, robbing Eister of a two-out knock, and YD strands two men in the first. We're scoreless after one here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network.
Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight. Hi, folks. It's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod.
Back at Red Wilson Field for the top of the second inning. Now we'd like to thank one of our sponsors, Milton Caterpillar, for sales and rentals of Caterpillar machinery, generators, and marine engines. Visit MiltonCat.com. Milton Cat, the Cape and Islands area Caterpillar dealer, is proud to be a sponsor of tonight's game. It's the top of the second inning. We're scoreless here at Red Wilson Field between Chatham and YD. Time called before the first pitch to Alex Terrell to begin this second inning. Ian Seymour worked through a scoreless top of the first besides hitting one man. Besides that, retired Chatham with relative ease, now facing Terrell to begin the second. First pitch, curveball, a called strike at the knees to the big lefty. It's 0-1. Terrell, 6'1", 220 pounds, hit 24 home runs this year for the Miami Hurricanes. The 0-1 from Seymour. Swinging a miss out in front of a changeup, and Seymour up 0-2 in this ACC matchup between Virginia Tech Seymour and Terrell from the Hurricanes of Miami.
Hey, Terrell thought he was getting a fastball right there, and it looks like a fastball all the way into the bottom, falls out of it right in front of home plate.
The 0-2. Barely fouled back by Terrell. Got a piece of the glove of Wells, but Terrell stays alive. And Seymour has some hum on the fastball, but it appears he loves to go to that curveball and changeup as the out pitch. Another 0-2. Misses downstairs. A ball and two strikes now to Terrell. Terrell 1-for-3 with a double so far for Chatham. He arrived a week ago today, but hasn't been able to play too often because of all the rainouts. The 2-2. Broken back grounder, softly first base side. Samuelson picks it up inside the chuck and steps on the first base bag for the first out here in the second. Seymour really jammed Terrell on that swing for the first out.
Yeah, Terrell chasing in off the plate there on what looked like a fastball, busting him in. And good job by Seymour on the location, and an easy play for Tate Samuelson at first base as well.
Now the outfielder, Drenis Ozuna, his first at-bat today. First pitch, check swing, a called strike nonetheless on a fastball from Seymour. Ozuna, the outfielder from Oklahoma Wesleyan, hitting 250 for the Anglers. The 0-1. Big cut and a miss on a fastball, and Seymour up quickly 0-2. Ozuna has scored four times. He's walked three times for Chatham so far this year. The 0-2, way outside from Seymour. Infield playing the righty to pull, the 1-2. Just up high, two balls, two strikes now to Ozuna.
Well, Seymour trying to challenge Ozuna at the top of the strike zone with his fastball, one of his go-to strikeout pitches as we've seen here so far. Well, I can't get him to chase there.
Here's the 2-2. Fastball misses away, three balls and two strikes. So after Seymour was up big to Ozuna, Ozuna has worked it back full. Here's the payoff from Seymour. Swing, foul tip, held by Wells. Second strikeout of the day for Ian Seymour on the mound, and a quick two outs here in the top of the second.
The shot spot for the University of Southern California. Number 49.
Ian Seymour impressing after Mason Hazelwood struggled a bit to find his command in the bottom of the first. Ian Seymour has been clicking despite the delay for YD. First pitch to Ben Ramirez, misses inside to the lefty, 1-0. Ramirez, the starting shortstop from USC, hitting 214 for the Anglers. Stands straight up and down in the lefty batter's box. Seymour with the 1-0. Skips it way out in front of home plate and on and off speed. Two balls and no strikes. Major shift on now for YD. Luke Waddell playing to the right of second base at shortstop. Riley King in the hole between second and third. He's the only man on the left side of the infield. The 2-0. Ramirez line drive, left side, softly hit. King over to his left, and he makes the grab. An easy 1-2-3 clean inning for Seymour on the mound. We're scoreless through an inning and a half. Coming up for YD is King, Yeager, and Hall. This is the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Bottom of the second inning back at Red Wilson Field. Another thank you to our sponsors. Cape Cod Healthcare is the leading provider of healthcare services for residents and visitors of Cape Cod, with two acute care hospitals and more than 450 physicians. More information, please visit capecodhealth.org. Cape Cod Healthcare, expert physicians, quality hospitals, superior care. We're scoreless here in the bottom of the second. First pitch of the frame misses inside to Riley King for ball one. Mason Hazelwood still out on the mound for Chatham to begin this scoreless bottom of the second inning. Here's the 1-0 to King. Line drive left field over Fort Ozuna. It's going to fall down in the gap. Ozuna cuts it off before it gets to the wall, relays it back to the infield, and King will hold up at first for a sharply hit leadoff single to begin the bottom of the second for YD. That's a loud way to get his YD Red Sox career started.
Yeah, Hazelwood tries to go back inside, and this time King is ready for it, expects it, gets out in front of it, and a solidly hit line drive into left center.
King wearing the high Red Sox, now leading off first base. The batter, R.J. Yeager. First pitch to Yeager, misses inside to the righty for ball one. And King, a new addition from the Georgia Bulldogs, had a really solid redshirt sophomore year, emerged as the starting third baseman, started every game at third for Georgia, hit 8 home runs. Check on first from Hazelwood, doesn't throw, and King is back safely. Now R.J. Yeager, 1-0 count to him. 1-for-7 for the Red Sox. He hits the first one in the air. Left field, Spencer Torkelson back a few steps in left. Barely has to move as he rounds it and gets it back to the infield for the first out now in the bottom of the second.
The right fielder from Clemson University.
Quick first two men here in the bottom of the second. King singles, Yeager flies to left, and with one out and King on first, it's Sam Hall. Hall 2-for-8 for YD thus far. One run, he did double in one of his two hits. The lefty Hazelwood looks in, he'll throw over to first, King back in time. Hall the speedster, mostly was atop the order for the Tigers this season at Clemson. We haven't really seen him let his wheels fly on the base paths yet, TJ, but once he's aboard, you have to imagine he's going to try to swipe some bags. Hazelwood, long look over to King at first. Here's the first pitch to Hall. Misses inside, delayed steal. King takes off for second, throw offline, and King slides in safely. Delayed takeoff from Riley King at first. Caught Brady Smith napping, and Riley King gets his first stolen base as a Red Sox. They are tied for the league lead entering today with 13 stolen bases, and that's number 14.
They've done it at a really high clip, too. 13 of 16 on stolen bases entering today, and Riley King with good base running over there at first.
Now in scoring position with one down. The 1-0 to Hall. Hit in the air, center field. Ozuna circling. King doesn't tag. Ozuna there, and he makes the catch coming in slightly towards left center. Two flyouts in a row from YD, and there's two down with King on second.
And King also beat both the Anglers middle infielders Ben Ramirez and Tyler Doans to the bag. They weren't expecting it either.
Beauty of the delayed steal really caught the entire Anglers defense napping. You don't get a great jump, but that element of surprise is there. Now the nine man in the order for YD, Drew Swift. 1-for-7 for YD thus far this season. First pitch fastball on the inside corner for strike one to Swift. We're scoreless here in the bottom of the second between Chatham and YD in this Eastern Division matchup. Both teams sitting at 9 points in this Eastern Division, 4 points back of Brewster, who's won 6 straight. Hazelwood looks at second. The 0-1 misses down and into Swift, the ball and a strike.
Here we go, Max. Here we go. Jimmy Tampa.
Swift, the middle infielder from Arizona State. Slightly open stance in the right-handed batter's box. King dancing around at second. One ball, one strike. The pitch. Line drive, base hit right field. King rounding third. Cabanis up with it in right. King coming towards the plate. The throw is high. Offline. King slides in safely. Swift advances to second. A two-out RBI hit for Drew Swift. Plates Riley King. And YD on top, 1-0 in the second.
Good piece of hitting there from Drew Swift, just taking that one the other way. It was a great throw by Kate Cavanis in right field. It got to home plate in plenty of time, and Brady Smith must have thought Riley King was farther down the line than he was, because it would have been a close play if Brady Smith turns around and tries to go after Riley King, instead just decides to fire it to second base to get Swift, and that's unable to get him either.
Definitely a strong throw that beat King, but pretty offline and high. First pitch to Brad Beasley, sharp grounder right side, gets under the glove of Terrell into shallow right field. Rounding third and coming to the plate is Swift. He'll score. Staying at first is Brad Beasley as he lined the first pitch sharply to first. Might be an error on Alex Terrell, and it is indeed an error, but YD takes the 2-0 lead after a clutch hit from Swift and now the miscue from Terrell. Swift was running quickly on the play. Two YD base runners score from second in what is now a two-run bottom of the second inning, taking a 2-0 lead over Chatham. With two outs, it's Luke Waddell at the plate. He'll take a first pitch called strike, and we can all take our breath here at Red Wilson Field. Before the single, or rather the sharply hit ball from Beasley that goes down as an error on Terrell, we were talking about the throw from Cabanis to try to cut down King at the plate. Here's the 0-1. Waddell grounds it up the middle. Doan's rounding it at second. He'll field and throw on a run to first in time to get Waddell. YD scores two runs in the second on two hits, one of them going to be unearned after the error by Alex Terrell at first base. 2-0, YD through two. We'll be back for the third on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network.
Curry College offers 14 Division III athletic teams in sports such as football, baseball, softball, basketball, hockey, soccer, lacrosse, tennis, cross country, and volleyball. Read about their success of the Curry Colonials and their championship teams. It's all online at www.curry.edu. Top half of the third inning. About set to get underway here from Red Wilson Field. 2-0 Red Sox over the visiting Chatham Anglers. Brian McLaughlin and TJ Mathewson here with you. Kate Cabanis, the eight man for Tom Holliday's squad, set to come to the plate. Playing in just his second game in a Chatham uniform. He bats from the left side at Oklahoma State. Seymour, the lefty, out of Virginia Tech. Wines fires the first pitch. Slider right there misses low for a ball. It's 1-0. Two strikeouts for Ian Seymour so far through two innings. He struck out 9 in his first outing of the season last Tuesday right here against Orleans. 1-0, swing and a pop-up. On the infield, foul territory. Austin Wells settling underneath it. He's there right to his left, and he'll make the catch for out number one.
Casual catch by Wells, but it's not an easy play for any catcher to pop up straight above you. And now the sun is out here at Red Wilson, so Wells dealing with that as well. Never even tossed the mask, and he's just so smooth back there. And everything really he does on the baseball diamond made that difficult play look really easy.
So here's Tyler Jones, the 9-hole hitter for Chatham. Seymour fires first pitch. It misses inside off the plate, and the count's 1-0. Seymour only facing one over the minimum so far. It's when he hit Spencer Torkelson with an out in the first inning. It's the 1-0, misses again a little low. It's 2-0. Red Sox have played one full game in the last 9 days. Rain and fog have kept them off the diamond for this second week of the Cape League season. 2-0 is fouled off first base side. It will find some fans down that way. And the count will go to 2-1. Thought we were getting in a game on Wednesday in Chatham. That got fogged out in the fourth inning. Here's the 2-1. Swing and a ground ball up the middle. Ranging over is Drew Swift. It kicks off his glove, and it goes into center field for a base hit. So Drew Swift, the whiny second baseman, ranging up the middle to his right, tried to make a sliding backhanded play. The ball takes a skip off the heel of his glove and trickles into center field for the Anglers' first base hit of the ballgame. And it will flip the lineup back over to Caden Polkovich, who, on a weird playback in the first inning, popped out to Seymour on the mound. Seymour sets out of the stretch the first pitch. It's chopped foul straight behind home plate. And the count is 0-1.
Would have been a great play for Swift to just get to that ball, but Dones moves well. Swift has a strong arm, can play shortstop, but planting in the outfield grass, I bet Dones still beats it to first. Definitely a hit, the first hit of the day for Chatham.
Polkovich awaits the 0-1. Seymour a peek over at first to Dones. 0-1, cut and a miss right there. A changeup from Seymour has worked the count 0-2.
Seymour, guys, going to sit in the 90, right around 90 with his fastball, but that changeup drops all the way down to about 75.
0-2, misses outside. The count will go to 1-2. Polkovich out of Northwest Florida State. Led them in home runs, walks, and runs this past season. He hit 273. Dones off of first. He has a steal on this young season. Seymour kicks and fires the 1-2. Swing, and it's popped up shallow left field. Backing up Luke Waddell. Calling him off is the left fielder Andrew Eister, and it falls in between them. So miscommunication between the two allows Caden Polkovich to reach on a base hit, and now back-to-back hits for the Anglers will bring up the dangerous Spencer Torkelson. Here with two on and one out.
Eister, I think he just wasn't sure where Waddell was at. Looked like Waddell had a beat on the ball, backpedaling into shallow left field, but Eister gets priority and left, made the call, but then realized he was going to come up a little bit short. I just don't think he knew where Waddell was at and would have allowed the shortstop to make the catch had he realized he was settled underneath it.
So a pair of base hits that just evade whiny fielders will bring up the dangerous Spencer Torkelson here with an out as Seymour checks on Dones at second base. As he steps off, Dones back, no one covering the bag. The left side of the infield is shading for Torkelson to pull. Riley King guarding the line at third, and Waddell deep in the hole at short. Outfielders are as well. 0-1, swinging a line drive down the left field line. It drops in for a base hit into the corner. One run comes home to score. Polkovich getting the wave on at third. He comes all the way around to score. Spencer Torkelson, an RBI double here in the third, has tied this ball game up at two. Didn't look like he got all of that one, maybe off the end of the bat a little. But that just shows you the power that Torkelson has, depositing that one down the left field line. And driving in two runs, his third and fourth RBIs of the summer, and his second double has tied this game up here in the third.
Definitely didn't get all of it, just hooked it down that line. Really strong swing. If you're Seymour, you're a little frustrated. Back-to-back hits before Torkelson were not hit all that well.
Here's the first pitch to Jamal O'Gwin, and misses for ball one. O'Gwin entered today leading the Cape in average, 407. This is the ninth game for the Anglers, as the 1-0 misses low, and the count will go to two balls and no strikes. So now Torkelson at second base. And O'Gwin at the plate. Anglers looking to take the lead here in the third. That go-ahead run is Torkelson on second. Seymour sets out of the stretch. Kicks. Here's the 2-0. Off speed, misses down and in the dirt. And the count will go to 3 balls and no strikes.
And O'Gwynn has been so hot to start this season. You wonder, with the base open, really attacking with a lot of off speed here, you don't want to make a mistake to O'Gwynn.
O'Gwynn out of USC batting from the right side. He awaits the 3-0. Fastball catches the strike zone. It's 3-1. All of a sudden, a nice sunny day here in Yarmouth. Had a storm system come through here this afternoon. Threatened with some lightning and some spurts of rain as Seymour checks in on Torkelson at second. Throw scooped out of the dirt by Swift. Torkelson back in plenty of time. Teammates out there at second base. Swift and Torkelson having a quick word after that.
I think that ball ricocheted off Torkelson's helmet into Swift's glove. I think that's what just happened. And Swift giving the signals, Torkelson okay, but that ball definitely hit Torkelson in the dome, and Swift somehow came away with it cleanly without it skipping into center field. Little game of pinball, and you're right, the two ASU teammates out there.
Seymour kicks, Torkelson heads towards third, it's swing, soft fly ball into center field, in comes Brad Beasley, he's there to make the catch. They'll throw behind the runner, and Drew Swift will set on second base, and Torkelson will be out. So the hit and run backfires for Tom Holliday. As Jamal O'Gwynn flies out to center field, to Brad Beasley makes a nice catch coming in, and then fires back to second base to double off Torkelson for out number 3 here in the third. But that's not before Torkelson ties up this game with a 2 RBI double. So we head to the bottom of the third inning here at Red Wilson Field, 2-2 between Chatham and YD on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Bottom of the third inning here from Red Wilson Field. 2-2 the score between Chatham and YD. It'll be 3-4-5 in the YD order to come to the plate to face Mason Hazelwood in his third inning of work. Austin Wells, Tate Samuelson, and Andrew Eister, the 3-4-5 men in Scott Pickler's lineup this afternoon. So Wells, the Cape League Player of the Week last week, will step in. 318 hitter entering play today. 3 home runs, 8 RBIs. Awaits the first pitch from Hazelwood. It's on the outside corner for a strike. 0-1. Wells hit all 3 of his home runs about a week ago. As the 0-1 is swinging a liner out to center field. It's dropping, and it drops in front of Dranis Ozuna for a base hit. Austin Wells reaches base for the second time today. He's 1-for-1 with a walk. And the leadoff hitter is on for the Red Sox, and that will bring up Tate Samuelson, who struck out swinging his first time up. The only Red Sox to go down on strikes so far here today.
What Wells just did is so impressive. Lefty-lefty, gets a breaking ball that starts at his shoulder, breaks over the plate, and he just goes right with it and pokes it to left center.
First pitch to Samuelson, up and outside.
And it wasn't a weak swing either. He just laid the barrel to it, didn't try to do too much, and got it pretty good wood into left center field. A professional swing and a good curveball from Hazelwood.
Samuelson ahead, 1-0, awaits the pitch. On the inside corner, catches the strike zone. It's 1-1. Samuelson, a nearly 300 hitter this past spring at Cal Poly. 298, 5 doubles, 5 home runs, and 39 RBIs. Native of San Diego, California, and Sarah High School. Hazelwood out of the stretch, the 1-1. It's fouled. Back up our way, and the count will go to a ball and two strikes. Samuelson spent last summer in the Northwoods League with the Waterloo Bucks, a 235 hitter. Three doubles, 15 RBIs. Right-hand hitter awaits as Hazelwood fires the 1-2. Up and outside with a fastball that time, and the count will even up at two balls and two strikes. All Big West honorable mention. His freshman year last season, now a sophomore, a rising junior at Cal Poly. Hazelwood sets the 2-2, swing and a miss, strike three. Samuelson down on strikes for the second time this evening. Strikeout number two for Mason Hazelwood. And that will bring up Andrew Eister for his second at-bat of the game. Was robbed of a base hit back in the first inning as he lined out to Caden Polkovich at third. Eister out of South Carolina digs into the righty box. Austin Wells now with an out, leads off of first. His first pitch misses low for a ball. It's 1-0. This game originally supposed to start at 4:45. Then we had a lightning delay for 30 minutes. First pitch got underway around 5:25. And the sun's out now, so it looks like we'll be good to go for the rest of this ball game. 1-0. Check swing down to first. They appeal, and it looks like he did go around.
Yeah, I don't even know if they appealed. Rick Emerson just called that one behind home plate.
So the count's even, 1-1 on Andrew Eister. Teammates with returning Whitey Red Sox Noah Campbell. Didn't get the start tonight for Picks Ball Club. Both of them have been playing left field. So the 1-1 is fouled back our way again. And the count will go to a ball and two strikes. Eister got off to a red hot start. 5 for his first 6 on the summer. It's cooled off a little bit since then. Well, hasn't really gotten to see consistent playing time. Partially due to weather. Partially due to just the abundance of talent on the roster. And trying to get guys in. Hazelwood sets right at the chip. Wells takes his lead off of first. Long pause out there on the bump. Here's the 1-2. Swing and a foul right at home plate. Smith could not hold on to that one in the dirt. And the count will stay at 1-2.
Hazelwood looked to bury the breaking ball in the dirt. Eister just was able to get the bat to it. Fouled it into the dirt before Smith could catch it cleanly on the foul tip.
2-2 our score. Here in the bottom of the third inning. Andrew Eister behind in the count 1-2. Hazelwood sets, now throws over to first base. Wells a dive just ahead of the tag from Alex Terrell. And the count stays at 1-2.
It's a good move from Hazelwood. He didn't have Wells leaning, but it was quick over to first base.
Yeah, very quick move. Just stepping off with the left foot off the rubber and a quick fire over to first. But Wells able to get back there in time. Eister awaits the 1-2. Here comes. Fastball up and outside. That'll even up the count on two balls and two strikes here on Eister.
We've seen Whitey these last couple games get really aggressive on the base paths, stealing a lot of bases. Wells runs really well for a catcher. Getting a good lead over there. That's why Hazelwood's paying attention.
2-2. Swing and a foul off the fence. Protecting the press box and the parking lot from foul balls behind home plate, and the count will stay at 2-2. Red Sox got their two runs in the bottom half of the second inning. A true swift RBI single came around to score on an error by the first baseman Alex Terrell. Hazelwood and Eister battling here with two strikes. Another throw over to first base. A quick move again. Wells this time back in standing. And the Anglers got their runs. And the next half inning, top of the third, a 2 RBI double from Spencer Torkelson. 2-2 on the way, swing and a miss for strike three. The ball gets away from Smith. Wells was going on the pitch. He'll coast into second base. Eister will be called out at home plate due to the fact that Wills was on first base. Can't advance to first base on a drop third strike if there's a runner on first with less than two outs. So the third strikeout for Mason Hazelwood, the second strikeout here in the third inning. That'll bring up the third baseman, Riley King, here with two outs. And are now a runner in scoring position with Wells over at second. And another quick meeting on the mound for the pitching coach for Chatham. Riley King emphatically in his first at-bat as a Whitey Red Sox in the second inning, led off the inning with a single. Stole a base, came around to score as well. As it looks like Hazelwood is going to get pulled from this game, and we're going to get a new pitcher here for Chatham in the third inning. We'll step aside for a second. We'll get you the new pitcher on the other side of this break on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. It'll be the Texas Longhorn, Ty Madden, out of the bullpen for Tom Holliday as he comes in relief of Mason Hazelwood. Just 2 2/3 innings for the lefty, 4 hits, a walk, and 3 strikeouts. The line is yet to be closed. Right now, he's at 2 runs, 1 earned, and responsible for Austin Wells on second base. So Madden, 2-pitch guy, fastball and a slider, will come out of the bullpen, hard thrower. Fastball sits anywhere from 90 to 94 miles an hour. Native of Cypress, Texas, will face Riley King. 1-for-1 on the day, a single back in the second inning in his Red Sox, here in his Red Sox debut. Madden sets out of the stretch, and his first move is a look at second base that Wells scoots back without anyone there to cover the back. Sun hiding behind some clouds now here at Red Wilson. His first pitch to King, swing and a dribbler out towards second base, and Tyler Dones throws it over to first base, and that'll be in time to retire the King and the Red Sox after the leadoff single from Austin Wells. We'll head to the fourth inning here from Red Wilson Field, 2-2. The score between Whitey and Chatham on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Top of the fourth here from Red Wilson Field, 2-2. The score between the Red Sox and the Anglers. TJ Mathewson and Brian McLaughlin here with you. Middle of the Chatham lineup set to come to the plate. 4, 5, and 6. Starting with the catcher out of the University of Florida, Brady Smith. He's one of two strikeout victims for Ian Seymour so far. The lefty out of Virginia Tech winds and fires the first pitch. Fastball sails outside. For ball one, it's 1-0. Seymour cruised through the first two innings, struggled in the top of the third, where he allowed two runs. 1-0, check swing, as the ball misses outside. First base umpire Rudy Fernbach says it didn't go around, and the count will go to 2-0. Smith, only 1-for-4, has played in two games so far as a Chatham Angler. 2-0, right down Main Street for strike one. It's 2-1. It was 1-for-3 against in the Angler's last game against Brewster. Smith bats from the right side, awaits the 2-1. It's fouled up and over home plate and out of play. And the count will even at 2-2. Spent last summer with the Kituat Kettleers. Hit .333 with a home run and 10 RBIs. Played in 24 games, one playoff game. Native of Niceville, Florida. As the 2-2 is chopped towards third base. Riley King fields in fair territory. Running throw over to first base. Pulls Samuelson off the bag. So Smith is safe at first base. Probably going to be an infield hit. And Smith probably would have beat that out anyway. And for the Anglers are going to lead off this fourth inning with a base runner. And that'll bring up Alex Terrell out of the University of Miami.
It is ruled an infield hit. Definitely a play that is makeable for King, but it would have been an outstanding one, or at least a really good one, had he been able to make the throw. Now the big shift on.
So here's Terrell. 0-for-1, grounded out to first base back in the second inning. First pitch misses inside for ball one, 1-0 count. Sky darkening a little bit again here at Red Wilson. He just passed some passing clouds and not more rain. Seymour sets 1-0. Grounder up the first base side, hugs the foul line, goes into foul territory. For a strike, evens up the count at 1-1.
And that time we saw a ton of run on probably a two-seam fastball from Seymour. Started over the middle and ended up in on the hands of Terrell. Looked great up at the letters and ended up in on the hands. That's a great pitch, especially against opposing lefties.
Seymour, deep breath. Lines and will throw over to first base instead. Brady Smith, not too much of a lead over there, is back standing up.
And it especially plays into this shift that Whitey has on right now, with King the only man on the left side of the infield, really trying to jam the lefties in, get them to roll over on a pitch inside.
Seymour kicks, and the 1-1 called a strike on the inside corner. Good off-speed pitch there from Seymour, and he's had 1-2. Terrell this season started 61 games with the Miami Hurricanes, 293, 24 home runs. Here's the 1-2. Swing and a pop-up. Third base side, foul territory there. The shift was on. King over from near the shortstop position in foul territory. He dives but can't make the catch. So the count will stay at 1-2. The infield was shifted for Terrell for him to pull towards right field. So King had a long way to go from his position. Over at short. And the ball will just drop foul, and the count will stay the same.
Yeah, showed great hustle. Essentially from the straightaway shortstop spot was King. Almost made the catch at about 10 feet foul down the left field line.
Seymour set right at the belt. 1-2 on the way. Swing and a drop. Third strike by Austin Wells. Might have got a foul tip of that, actually, at home plate. Is that right? So Terrell staying alive in the count.
Tough to tell from our vantage point if that one hit the dirt or Wells mitt first after the foul tip from Terrell, but just manages to stay alive.
See if that comes back to cost Seymour here. He sets again ahead 1-2. Smith off of first. Here's the 1-2. Swing and another foul out of play. This time third base side, well off into the crown. And the count will go to one, will stay again at one ball and two strikes.
Seymour's frustrated he hasn't been able to put away Terrell. Be interesting to see what he goes with. I'd expect more off speed. Maybe he'll try to drop the changeup in on the hands.
Seymour steps off for a second, now steps back on. Terrell digs back into the lefty box. He's ready. Here's the 1-2. Swing and a miss, strike three. Goes with the changeup there and gets Terrell to fan right over the top of it for strike three.
Way out in front that time. That's a great pitch from Seymour. He has really three plus pitches.
Third strikeout of the game for Ian Seymour. As he gets Terrell for the first out here in the fourth inning. And it'll bring up the center fielder, Dranis Ozuna. He's 0 for 1 with a strikeout today. Seymour sets first pitch. Inside corner, fastball, called a strike. It's 0-1. You could see Seymour emphatically catch that ball back from Austin Wells. So he's finally glad that he was able to put Terrell down. He kicks. Here's the 0-1. Fastball again on the inside corner and called a strike again. It's quickly 0-2 on Ozuna. A 250 hitter so far in this season. Three doubles, three walks, seven strikeouts for him. He's yet to drive in his first run. Seymour kicks home the 0-2. It's fouled straight back into the fence. The count stays at 0-2. Well, Seymour, due to all this rain, got a couple extra days off. Usually here in the Cape, you pitch about once every week as a starter. But Seymour had to wait a week and 4 days to make his next start. After his brilliant first start, a quick throw over to first base, Smith dives back in plenty of time. He pitched on last Tuesday, against Orleans back on June 11th. 5 innings, 9 strikeouts for him. 0-2. High fastball misses outside. And the count's now 1-2. But it might feel like it throws off your routine a little bit if you just have to keep waiting.
I wanted to.
Never known when you're next, let alone next game you're going to play due to this weather. 1-2 fastball misses high. And the count will now even at 2-2.
I can't.
But now it's time for them to buckle up. A lot of games in a row coming up. Of course, off day on next Thursday. Fenway Day. Seymour sets 2-2. Swing and a foul straight back again off the fence. And the count will stay even.
Now again, he's been up here yet to be able to put away Ozuna, mostly going at him with the fastball. He's been in the zone a lot more this inning, but hasn't put away a lot of guys. Maybe he goes with the curveball here.
2-2 on the way. Off speed, misses outside for 3. Now they got the runner. Smith caught in between. He thought it was 4, so Drew Swift will throw down to Tate Samuelson, and he'll apply the tag. Well, a gifted out there for the Red Sox.
Heads up, defense, both Luke Waddell, the whole infield really, Waddell, King, Swift, calling for the baseball from Austin Wells, who was just kind of bewildered, throwing the money down to second, and then Smith just gave in for the easy putout.
Here's the 3-2. Swing and a miss, strike three. Ian Seymour with the fastball sets down Dranis Ozuna on strikes. Strikeout number 4 for the lefty out of Virginia Tech. We'll head to the bottom of the fourth inning. Here from Red Wilson Field, it's Red Sox 2, Anglers 2, here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Back here for the bottom of the fourth inning from Red Wilson Field. 2-2, the score between YD and Chatham. It'll be R.J. Yeager, Sam Hall, Drew Swift scheduled to come to the plate against Ty Madden. First pitch, fastball over on the inside corner for strike. It's 0-1. Yeager back in the second inning as he watches a strike. It's 0-2. Flew out to left field. So a couple of defensive changes for the Anglers here in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Caden Polkovich takes over in center for Drainus Ozuna as Yeager fouls that one back. And the count's still no balls and two strikes. And then Jorge Arenas over at third. As the 0-2 again fouled out of play first base side. And the count will stay at no balls and two strikes. Arenas, the second year Chatham Angler. Utility infielder in at third. Madden, the righty out of Texas. Out of the windup, staring in at Brady Smith behind the plate. Here's the 0-2. Again fouled out of play along the first base side. Count stays 0-2. Two runs each for these two squads. Red Sox getting their two in the bottom half of the second. Anglers in the fourth inning is another flare foul territory. As that one's caught by a fan down the first base side. In play.
I don't think that
in foul territory, but outside of the out of play line.
Terrell would, he wouldn't have got there, but that was definitely in play. The umpires are going to have a conversation there. I don't think anything should come of that, but we'll see what the decision is.
Yeager broke his bat on that one. He's going to have to get some new lumber. So if they did think that Terrell had a chance at that one, they'd probably just call Yeager out.
Definitely within their right to do so, but like you said, if Terrell had a chance to make the catch, now they're going to actually head down and talk with the other umpire and maybe Scott Pickler down the third baseline.
Home plate umpire Rick Emerson getting the word to pick. It looks like Yeager will not be called out. Yep, he'll dig back in. He's behind 0-2. Madden out of the wind, 0-2 on the way. Swing and a foul right between the wickets of Brady Smith behind the plate. And the count stays at 0-2. Good battle here between Yeager and Ty Madden. Yeager awaits the 0-2. Again, another foul ball out of play, this time down the third base side. And the count stays at 0-2. Yeager, a sophomore out of Mercer, appeared in two games with the Falmouth Commodores last summer. So his second season here on Cape Cod. 0-2 on the way. Swing and a miss, strike three. Finally, Ty Madden able to set down R.J. Yeager on strikes after a few fouls. So strikeout number one for Ty Madden. And that will bring up Sam Hall, the right fielder. Hall today 0-for-1. He flew out to center field back in the fourth. Or pardon, back in the second. As he gets his second at-bat here in the fourth inning. Utility man out of Clemson awaits the first pitch. Misses down and inside for a ball. It's 1-0. Decent crowd here at Red Wilson Field. Didn't look like we were going to get a big crowd after all the rain we had. And the threat of thunderstorms. 1-0 is chopped foul right in front of the Whitey dugout. And the count evens up at a ball and a strike. But the rain cleared away after a 30-minute delay from first pitch. We're playing baseball here on Cape Cod. Second day of summer. 1-1. It's fouled up and out of play behind home plate, and the count will go to one ball and two strikes on Sam Hall. Yesterday, which was supposed to be the longest day of the year, the summer solstice, we got nothing but rain. 1-2. Swing and a foul. First base side, foul territory. Terrell giving it a look near the fans, and it will trickle its way out of play. And the count will stay at a ball and two strikes. So these windy hitters here in the fourth have done a good job with two strikes of fouling off some pitches from Ty Madden.
Madden, I'd try to throw a curveball down here out of the zone. He's only thrown one ball so far in this outing, 12 strikes, so really living in there. Maybe try to expand the zone.
1-2, fastball, airmails, misses Brady Smith, goes all the way to the backstop.
That'll extend the zone a little bit.
Yeah. Threw that one up and out of the strike zone, but just a little bit too out of the strike zone for Brady Smith to get a glove on it behind the plate. So it counts even at 2-2. Matt and Wines, here comes. Off speed, down low and in the dirt. Full count. Three balls and two strikes here on Sam Hall. Hit 257 this spring for the Clemson Tigers in 61 games. Showed some decent power with 12 doubles and 7 home runs. 3-2. Swing and a miss, strike three. Blows the fastball right by Sam Hall. And Ty Madden has set down both Red Sox hitters he's seen in this inning on strikes. That'll bring up the second baseman, Arizona State Sun Devil, Drew Swift. RBI single back in the second inning for him. And came around to score on an E3. First pitch, check swing. On a ball up and out of the strike zone, first base umpire Rudy Fernbach says he goes around. And the count's 0-1. A one on the way. Fouled up and out of play. Losing a lot of foul balls here in the fourth inning. And the count will go to 0-2.
These wide hitters just can't quite square up Ty Madden. They've been on the pitches, fouling them off, but they're kind of all defensive swings. Nobody's really letting them rip with great cuts in any of these pitches.
The wind, the 0-2 to Swift. Swing and a pop fly into medium depth right field. Cade Kamenis out, settles under it, and he finds it up in the sky, retires Drew Swift for out number three. So four up and four down for Ty Madden out of the Anglers' bullpen. So we'll head to the fifth inning. Here in Yarmouth, it's 2-2, the score between the Red Sox and the Anglers here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network.
Top of the fifth inning, we're even at two between YD and Chatham. Ian Seymour back out on the mound for his fifth inning of work today for YD. He'll face 7-8-9 of this Chatham order here to begin the fifth. Ben Ramirez, the shortstop from USC, leads off, facing a sharp shift from the YD infield. First pitch to the lefty, Ramirez sails high and tight for ball one. Luke Waddell almost directly up the middle. Now he takes a few steps over to the right side of second base. Drew Swift in the outfield grass at second. And King in the hole at third. The 1-0. Curveball sailed up over the head of Ramirez. Not even close. Wells didn't even offer his glove at it to try to reel in that errant pitch. It's two balls and no strikes to Ramirez. Ramirez lined out to King at third base back in the second. Here's the 2-0. Fastball off the plate inside. It's three balls and no strikes. There is some action for Whitey in their bullpen down the left field line. The 3-0 from Seymour. Fastball right down the chute for strike one. Shadows starting to creep across the infield here at Red Wilson Field in this fifth inning. The 3-1 pitch. Ramirez fists it foul down the first baseline, and it's run full with nobody down. If I had said that to you an hour ago, TJ, shadows starting to play a factor, you might have called me crazy with the little bit of a rain delay we had.
Yeah, no shadows if the sun's not out. You've not seen the sun a whole lot here this past week.
The 3-2. Ramirez fouls it away towards the Chatham dugout first base side, and we'll get another payoff pitch from Seymour. Whitey looking to play just their second full game in almost a full calendar week. So much rain here on Cape Cod. Only 7 games in about 2 weeks. The payoff pitch, down and in, ball 4 to Ramirez, and a leadoff walk for Chatham to begin the fifth.
The right fielder from Oklahoma State University.
First walk of the day issued from Seymour. Second free pass. He hit Torkelson with a pitch all the way back in the first. Now Cade Cabiness from Oklahoma State with the man on first, nobody down, top 5. Seymour from the stretch. First pitch to Cabiness. Breaking ball off the plate away to the lefty. It's 1-0. Cabiness popped out in foul territory to Austin Wells in the third. Seymour sets the 1-0. Off speed, called strike to Cabiness, a ball and a strike. Cabiness is 1-for-3 in just a short stint with Chatham so far. That one hit was a solo home run in his first at-bat for the Anglers. Seymour with the 1-1. Misses down and away, scoots away from Wells. Ramirez will move up 90 feet, scampering to second. A breaking ball just ticked off the glove of Austin Wells and bounced about 10 feet away to his right, allowing Ramirez to get into scoring position with nobody down. Probably a passed ball there on Austin Wells. 2-1 count to Cabiness. Here's the pitch from Seymour. Fastball down and away, 3 balls and a strike. So a leadoff walk and now a 3-1 count. Seymour losing his command a bit here in the fifth. Only 2 runs for Chatham came in a 3-hit third inning. But none of those hits struck particularly all that hard. Now the 3-1. Swing and a miss from Cabiness and back-to-back full counts from Seymour. He lost Ramirez to a walk and now trying to prevent the same fate to Cade Cabiness. Drew Swift in the hole at second. Now if the double play is out of order. Waddell holds on Ramirez. The 3-2. Fouled out of play left side. We'll see another payoff from Seymour. Seymour, the Virginia Tech product, 1-0 on this season for YD. He worked 5 innings last time out against Orleans. Another payoff pitch. Off speed, called strike 3. Freezes Cade Cabiness with the changeup. Fifth strikeout of the day for Seymour, and there's 1 down in the fifth.
Yeah, Cabiness looked like he was expecting a fastball right there. Got changeup and just could not pull the trigger as it dropped right over the inside corner. A beauty of a pitch there for me and Seymour.
First backwards K of the day for Seymour. The other 4 have all been of the swinging variety. With 1 down, now it's Tyler Dones. He singled and scored to begin the third. First pitch, line drive, right field through the infield. That's a hit. Rounding third base Ramirez. He'll be held up there. Sam Hall came in quickly and played it on a hop in shallow right. Runners at the corners now, and 1 down for Chatham as Tyler Dones reaches for his 2nd time today with a single.
Dones finds an open part of the infield on the right side, but just doesn't quite hit it hard enough for Ramirez to get a chance to come home from and score. Hall out there in right. Came up on that one, came up firing, hit his cutoff man. And I think Pick's going to make a pitching change here, and it'll be it for Ian Seymour here in the fifth.
Runners on the corners, one down. We're even at two in the top of the fifth inning. We'll get you the new pitcher when we return here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Back at Red Wilson Field, it's the top of the fifth. Eric Tolman enters the game for YD on the bump, replacing Ian Seymour. Seymour's line not yet finished, but Tolman enters in a sticky situation. Runners on the corners, one down for the Chatham Anglers, and the top of their lineup coming up for Chatham. It's Caden Polkovich at the plate, the righty to face the lefty Tolman. Polkovich 1-for-2 today as a single, and he scored in the third inning. But Tolman, the man out of the bullpen for Scott Pickler, he was really good out of the pen this year for the Arizona State Sun Devils. A 2.83 ERA was atop the team, had a couple of saves, and only a .198 batting average against, which also led the team. Throws pretty hard from the left side. First pitch to Polkovich, a breaking ball that misses in for ball one. With runners in scoring position this year at Arizona State against Tolman, they were just 9 of 54, or 1.66, batting average against the 1-0. Slider misses inside, two balls and no strikes. He quickly falls behind Polkovich. He's made one appearance for YD so far this season on the mound. He went two innings, struck out two, the 1-0. Bounced foul by Polkovich. Now two balls and a strike, rather. Dones was moving from first on the pitch there. Might be some action with runners on the corners for the Anglers. We're tied at two here in the top of the fifth. On deck, the ever-dangerous Spencer Torkelson. The 2-1. Fastball misses down low. Three balls and a strike. Polkovich, even stance, slight wiggle of the bat. Tolman checks on first. Samuelson has to knock it down to keep it in front. Three balls and a strike to Polkovich. Polkovich just moved to left, or rather center field, last defensive inning as Jorge Arenas replaced Trenis Ozuna at third. The 3-1. Lifted in the air, first base side, foul territory. Sam Hall over it near the line. He'll make the catch with a runner on third. Runner coming towards the plate, throw into second. The catch, the tag, not in time. A run scores on the pop out down the right field line. Moving over to second base is Tyler Dones. Both runners advance 90 feet, and it's 3-2 Chatham.
And that's where the leadoff walk from Seymour comes back to bite you. Ben Ramirez coming down the line and scoring. And at that point, if you're Sam Hall, you got to make a decision. Either get the sure out there in the corner and let the run score, or he could have just let it drop and then possibly had Polkovich ground into a double play. And Natsu looks like they're just going to intentionally walk Torkelson.
They'll just point him to first base to put runners on first and second with two outs. They'll elect to face Jamal O'Gwin.
And that would have been a fun matchup, teammate versus teammate. Pair of Sun Devils there.
Tolman with good strikeout stuff, great power. Torkelson, great power at the plate. Another guy with pretty good pop, Jamal O'Gwin now. First pitch from Tolman. A frisbee slider misses down low. Man, that thing is sharp.
Yeah, it has a lot of move, a lot of tilt on it. Fastball, not the hardest throw in the world. Sits around 89, 90 miles an hour with the fastball, but the off-speed stuff is supreme.
1-0 to O'Gwin. Tolman looks to second and delivers. It looked like a changeup for a called strike, 1-1. Dones on second. He had a one-out single. On first is Spencer Torkelson. It's 3-2 Chatham here in the top of the fifth. Swift holding Dones at second. Tolman from the stretch sets at the belt. One ball, one strike. Two looks to second. He'll step off.
It's always fun with these matchups. Some trash talking they can do.
All sorts of Sun Devil talent between these two squads. Now the 1-1 to O'Gwin. Off speed, misses high and away. Wells pump fakes to second, but nobody home, so he has to hold the pearl tight. Two balls and a strike to O'Gwin. We saw that the last time Whitey and Chatham faced off. John Beller from USC and Jamal O'Gwin from USC. Ben Ramirez, a Trojan as well, facing the lefty starter for Whitey. The 2-1. Misses down and in. Wells blocks it off his mask. The ball trickles up the third baseline. And actually got a piece of O'Gwin, a hit by pitch, so everybody can slow up their jog and just move up 90 feet. They're now loaded, however, with two outs for Brady Smith.
Now, there is one thing that Tolman struggled with at school this spring. It was his control. At times would get a little wild. A lot of walks.
Bases are loaded, two outs, top of the fifth inning. One run already across for Chatham, looking for more against Eric Tolman. First pitch to Smith. Misses low for ball one. Smith, 1-for-2, singled in the fourth inning. He struck out swinging to end the first. Tolman shakes his head a couple times at Wells. Now the 1-0. Misses down low. Two balls and no strikes to Smith. Nowhere to put it. Whitey jumped out early to a 2-0 lead today, but it's three unanswered Chatham runs to put them up by one here in the fifth. Tolman still from the stretch. The 2-0. Line drive, back up the middle. Swift is over. He's there to make the catch behind second. Eric Tolman leaves the bases loaded for the Anglers here in the fifth. They get one on just one hit in the inning and take a 3-2 lead over Whitey. Bottom of the fifth coming up, top of the order for Whitey due up here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Bottom of the fifth inning, we're back at Red Wilson Field. It's Chatham 3, YD 2 as the Red Sox come to bat here against Ty Madden to begin the fifth inning. The top of the Red Sox order due up Beasley, Waddell, and Wells. All have reached base once so far today. Beasley reached on an error in the second. That brought home a run for YD. Also flew out in the first. First pitch from Madden in the fifth frame is a fastball called strike on the inner half of home plate. 0-1 to Beasley.
Brad Beasley.
Madden works quickly. The 0-1 grounded third base side foul. Pick bobbles it down there at third. Thought he had a chance to make that play, the recent Hall of Fame inductee here in the Cape Cod League. 0-2 count to Beasley. Madden winds and delivers. Fastball misses upstairs for ball one. Did you see what Pick had to say when he said he got the phone call this offseason about when he got the call that he was inducted into the hall here in Cape Cod?
I probably did, but it's not coming to mind right now.
1-2, skied by Beasley, left center, over Caden Polkovich near the warning track, and he makes the catch above his head for the first out here in the fifth. Still 3-2 Chatham, but Pick said when he got the call, he said, oh boy. Maybe Steve fired me. Steve Foucher here, the GM of YD. Maybe he thinks I'm too old. No, you're just inducted into the Cape Cod Hall of Fame, Pick. That's all. First pitch to Luke Waddell, lined left center, over fourth, the left fielder Torkelson for a catch. A quick second out as Waddell barreled it, but Tork just had to backpedal a few steps towards the wall. And a first pitch out from Waddell.
Austin Wells.
Quick two outs in the fifth for Ty Madden. He has retired all six YD men he's faced so far on the mound. His team leading by one here in the bottom of the fifth. Now he'll face maybe the most dangerous man in the YD order, Austin Wells. First pitch to Wells. Fastball misses down and away for ball one. Wells has reached twice today. Walked in the first, singled in the third. Madden from the windup, the 1-0. Fastball just below the knees to Wells. Two balls, no strikes. Doesn't surprise you at all about Pick that he would think getting a call middle of the winter, oh no, maybe they fired me. The 2-0. Wells drives it in the air, deep right field, going back Cabinas. Now he'll circle, plenty of room, now a step in to make the catch above his head. Wells didn't quite get all of it off the end of the bat a bit. Three flyouts in the fifth frame for YD. They go in order against Ty Madden. It's 3-2, Chatham through five. This is the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Top of the sixth inning here at YD, it's Chatham 3, Red Sox 2. Terrell Ozuna Ramirez due up for Chatham, rather Terrell, and then Arenas and Ramirez. Arenas came in back in the fifth for Ozuna. Eric Tolman back out on the mound for YD, so we begin this sixth. First pitch of the sixth frame misses down and away to Terrell for ball one. Shift on for Whitey. Three men on the right side of the infield. Drew Swift even on the outfield grass. 1-0. Fastball misses in. Two balls and no strikes. And as we begin this sixth inning, TJ, we realized, hey, we've gone final. Official game. How about that is right. The 2-0 from Tolman. Terrell takes a called strike at the knees. Two balls and a strike. Feels like we've had so few of these. Since Monday, YD played 9 against Orleans on Thursday, and that's been all. The 2-1. Breaking ball misses away. Three balls and a strike.
And even that game, we didn't think we were going to get to 9.
There was thoughts about calling it after 4. Fog and rain in Orleans that evening, and we somehow made it to 9. The 3-1. Terrell crushes it high in the air right field, but really high up there. A skyscraper, Sam Hall rounds it and actually has to trot in a few steps for the first out here in the sixth as he makes the catch. That ball was up in the clouds, and in the bright sunshine, Terrell just got underneath it, one down in the sixth.
And Terrell, 24 home runs this spring at Miami. Sounded like he got it on the barrel, but just under it. That one, Mitch, up there with the clouds, eventually came back down into the glove of Sam Hall.
Now Jorge Arenas with one down in the sixth. Base is clear. Arenas from the right side. He'll take a first pitch from Tolman that misses low, ball one. Arenas rocking the high stirrup blue socks for Chatham, the 1-0. He swings and fouls it into the glove of Wells, 1-1. You a fan of the stirrups look, TJ?
I like the stirrup look.
Me too.
I do. Very classic look.
Couple for both sides rocking the stirrups. Austin Wells behind the plate for YD. Torkelson for Chatham also going stirrups, the 1-1. Fastball down the middle for a called strike 2, 1-2. Drew Swift with the stirrups at second for YD. At third, Riley King, just with the high, straight red sock, almost up above his knee. The 1-2. Arenas takes, called strike 3. Tolman sits him down, paints a fastball on the outer edge. Two down in the sixth.
Great pitch there from Tolman, just dotting that outside corner. Good job by Wells, framing it behind the plate, making it easy for Rick Emerson. Call strike 3.
2 down now in the inning for Ben Ramirez. Lefty-lefty matchup. First pitch fouled off by Ramirez off his own foot. Strike 1. Ramirez walked and scored last half inning in the fifth. 0-1 misses up high. A ball and a strike. He was the go-ahead run in the fifth inning for Chatham. They're on top 3-2. 1-1 count from Tolman. Here's the pitch. Outside. Two balls and a strike. Bases are clear with two down in the top of the sixth inning. Sun splashed. Red Wilson Field today. The 2-1 to Ramirez. He swings and fouls it down the left field line towards the Red Sox bullpen and out of play. Two balls, two strikes. Whitey again with the dramatic shift on for the lefty Ramirez. Waddell to the right side of second base. Riley King stands alone on the left side of the infield. The 2-2. Line drive, deep to center field. Beasley going back on it. He's near the fence. He'll leap at the wall. It's off his glove and out of here. Ben Ramirez, a line drive out of the park to center field. Solo shot for Ramirez in the sixth. His first home run of the year gives Chatham a 4-2 lead. Brad Beasley almost brought that one back, leapt at the wall and had a play on it, but it just snuck out.
We saw Beasley slowing down as he's getting near that wall. There's no warning track here at Red Wilson Field, so these outfielders very cautious when they're going that far back. And Beasley able to size up the wall, timed it great, just unable to haul that one in as it did look like it bounced off his glove and over the wall for a home run.
First pitch called strike to Cade Cabinas. You could see there's an experience level there for Beasley as well. 0-1. Slider misses inside. A ball and a strike. The returning Whitey Red Sox has some experience with that wall out there, at least a little bit, judging fly balls. He timed the leap well. The 1-1. Swing and a miss by Cabinas. A ball and two strikes.
And normally that's a fly ball. A center fielder will just guide under going back and make the catch. But short center field fence here at Red Wilson, 352 to Dennaway Center.
1-2 count to Cabanis. The pitch misses down and away. Two balls, two strikes. Would have been a highlight reel catch had Beasley been able to reel it in. Instead, Chatham takes a 4-2 advantage here in the top of the sixth inning. Tolman winds the 2-2. Swinging a foul ball back off the leg of Austin Wells. We'll see another 2-2 from Tolman. Chatham has scored in back-to-back frames, four unanswered runs total. The Whitey offense has been shut down by Ty Madden. The 2-2 from Tolman. Fastball called strike three right on the outside corner. Second backwards K of the frame from Tolman to retire the Chatham lineup. But they get one on a Ben Ramirez solo shot to center. 4-2 Chatham through 5.5. This is the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Bottom of the sixth, Chatham on top, 4-2 over YD. 4, 5, and 6 due up the middle of the YD order here against Ty Madden. But Ty Madden has been perfect through seven men that he's faced in relief today for Mason Hazelwood. The righty from Texas has been dealing. First pitch to Samuelson, soft liner, right side, gets to Dones on one hop. He'll sidearm a low throw to first, but Terrell bends down to a knee to retire Samuelson for the first out here in the sixth on just one pitch. That's now 8 straight retired from Ty Madden on the mound in, at this point, almost 3 innings of total work for Madden on the mound. He has been spotless, but now a pinch hitter for YD to try to end that trend. It's Noah Campbell pinch hitting for his South Carolina Gamecock teammate Andrew Eister here in the sixth.
You know, the control's been there for Madden. The velocity's been there. If he has given up any contact, it's all been soft like the ground out that Samuelson just had.
First pitch fastball misses way up high to Campbell. The switch hitter hitting from the left side. Campbell's been great since returning to YD in 2019. Really no other adjectives to describe it aside from great as a Red Sox. The 1-0. Big cut and a miss from Campbell, 1-1. He's 5-for-8, has scored 3 runs, driven in 4, and he's hit a home run. Last year hit well above 360 for YD. The 1-1. Fastball misses low and away to Campbell. 2 balls and a strike. The team MVP last year, you saw him and you know how great he truly was last year, TJ, and that's just continued. The 2-1 from Madden. Fouled off third base side by Campbell. It's out of play. 2 balls, 2 strikes.
Yeah, just special with the bat. I mean, from both sides of the plate, especially from this left side, hit almost 380 from the left side last season.
Time called by Campbell.
And showed power, showed speed, versatility on defense, outfield, and infield. Played a lot of second base for Whitey last year.
The 2-2. Breaking ball misses in the dirt. It's smothered by Smith. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Played primarily outfield. I would expect him to just shift right into left field where Andrew Eister was playing. Madden winds the payoff pitch. High and away, and Noah Campbell on base yet again. His second walk of the season, and he's aboard with one down for Whitey. They're trailing by two here in the bottom of the sixth.
And the first base runner that Ty Madden has allowed, he's going to have to keep an eye on Nona. Three swipe bags so far this season, had all three of them on Thursday in Orleans.
Now a guy that's really impressed me in just one game for Whitey, Riley King, the third baseman from Georgia. He singled and scored in the second. Second time facing Madden today. First pitch grounder right at the shortstop Ramirez. Flips to second one. Dones relay to first in time. Taylor made 6-4-3 double play. Ends the frame for YD. They trail 4-2 through six. Ty Madden has cruised through 3 1/3 innings on the mound, only allowing one man to reach. Chatham by 2-6. This is the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. Top of the seventh inning, a new arm on the mound for YD. It's Brady Corrigan relieving his Sun Devil teammate at Arizona State, Eric Tolman. It's 4-2 Chatham as we begin this top of the seventh inning. It will be Tyler Dones to lead things off for the Anglers against Corrigan. Corrigan, 30 appearances, led the team this year for Arizona State, making his debut for YD. In those 30 appearances, he piled up a 5.61 ERA, but was an honorable mention All-Pac-12 selection. The righty works from the windup here against Dones. First pitch, fastball at the knees for a called strike, 0-1. 65 strikeouts to 28 walks for Corrigan at Arizona State this year for the Sun Devils. Here's the 0-1. Called strike on the outer edge to Dones. He disagrees. It's 0-2. Here's the 0-2 pitch to Dones. Sharp grounder back up the middle, and that's a base hit for Dones. He's 3-for-3 today with three singles. Great day at the bottom of the lineup for Chatham. Actually, my apologies, folks. That's not as I initially mentioned Corrigan on the mound. That's Michael Weisberg out there for YD.
And we're talking about all this sun that we've had, and all of a sudden, here at Red Wilson Field, you look up, there's one of the darkest clouds I have seen in quite a while hovering over Red Wilson Field. Hopefully, it's just passing.
First pitch misses down low to Caden Polkovich, the switch hitter for Chatham. Top of their lineup. Nobody down, a man on first here in the top of the seventh, and now a slight breeze blowing into our broadcast booth to go with that menacing cloud. Not supposed to get any more rain at this point, but you never know. The 1-0 off the plate inside, two balls and no strikes.
Even though we mistaked Weisberg for Corgan, Brady warming up down in the bullpen for YD down the left field side.
2-0, grounded foul. Great play by the first base coach of Chatham. Dropped the Evo shield, made the snag barehanded. Relayed it immediately back to Weisberg. That's strike one of the at-bat to Polkovich.
Wow, that's a fantastic play with the bare hand.
Everybody else is officially on notice. That's play of the year by a base coach at this point in the Cape Cod League. Gonna have to get his name. The 2-1 to Polkovich. Runner takes off, misses down and away to Wells. Can't handle it. Doan slides to second safely. Goes about a third of the way towards third base, but will saunter back to second. And it just got really dark and breezy here at Red Wilson Field. It is an official game, but definitely ominous, to say the least, as there's paper, some hats blowing around now, a couple jackets being tossed on. Runner on second, nobody down for Chatham. Weisberg sets at the belt. Here's the 3-1 to Polkovich. Ground ball, left side, right at the shortstop, Waddell. Looks to third, where Doans goes. Throw to first, just in time. The helmet of Polkovich went flying. Waddell hesitated at shortstop as Doans ran in front of him. Maybe ill-advised from Doans, but Whitey gets one out, and Doans moves up to third.
Waddell, for a second, thought about going behind the runner. Doans to third base instead. After a hesitation, decides to go to first base, and a good strong throw just in front of the base runner in Caden Polkovich.
Now the infield comes in for YD against Spencer Torkelson with one out. Three infielders on the left side for the Red Sox. Weisberg's first pitch sails past Wells to the backstop. Doans is going to cross home plate and score. A wild pitch from Michael Weisberg looked like an off-speed grip and just sailed it over the head of Torque. 5-2 now Chatham. Doans scores for the second time today, and they lead by three here in the seventh.
Like it just slipped, and Doans, as soon as he sees that, takes off from third. He scores easily.
Here's the 1-0 to Torque. Fastball misses away. Two balls, no strikes. So far today, Torkelson as lightning. They're going to clear the fields. Torkelson's one for one. He was intentionally walked and hit by a pitch. Only really seen two pitches. So close to getting to see Torque hit here in this one. There's the thunder that accompanies the lightning. Currently 5-2. I'm going to shut the window. That's quite the breeze. Might need to shut the window. The lightning accompanies a 30-minute delay. We've had one of these already here at Red Wilson Field today. As it stands, it's Chatham 5, YD 2, TJ. Definitely going to be interesting.
Appeared over Red Wilson Field here in the seventh inning. I mean,
the window's going shut. We're going to turn off the crowd, Mike.
Are going shut, but that cloud that came over the field, it looked like it appeared out of nowhere, and all of a sudden it's right over Red Wilson Field. We hear a flash of thunder, a clap of lightning. And we're going to have to wait 30 more minutes to continue this one if they choose to continue it.
Good news is this one's gone a full five. We're in the top of the seventh. So even if it were to revert back to the sixth, that run from Doans earlier in this frame wouldn't count. It would be a 4-2 final with a Chatham victory. Of course, the YD faithful here at Red Wilson Field don't want that. They are looking for a comeback for their Red Sox today, but it is currently dark. No rain in the forecast, only a 30% chance at 8, but just the weird weather on Cape Cod continues. TJ, today the YD Red Sox lineup has gone silent, mostly from time added on the mound. They scored two runs off Mason Hazelwood in the second and were threatening again in the third when Madden was introduced, and he has since faced 10 men, only walked Noah Campbell, and retired everybody else in 10 outs on the mound.
Yeah, this just shows you the strength of this Anglers pitching staff and the two guys, Hazelwood and Madden, that the Red Sox have seen both times they've played the Anglers, the last time they played the Anglers, and then now. And It's, you know, the hitters haven't really been able to get comfortable, and the Chatham pitchers and Ty Madden, Michael, or in Hazelwood have just been dealing.
They have certainly been dealing. It's currently 5-2 Chatham. We are in a lightning delay here, folks, at Red Wilson Field. We're going to try to keep you updated. TJ and I are going to step aside here in a moment. Follow along as well with all of our social media here at YD. It's at YD_Red Sox on Twitter. So give us a follow there. We'll keep you updated as now some rain starts to fall here at Red Wilson Field. We'll try to keep you updated as much as we can, TJ, but who knows about this one as well as it starts to get dark here at Red Wilson. No lights for the Red Sox at their home field as well. I wouldn't be shocked if this is all we see today.
Yeah, me either. But the way this weather has been, it's just been bizarre. The amount of rain, lightning, and
that's some hail, I think, just hit the window.
Stuff. Oh, boy. We got everything here at Red Wilson.
Tarps are quickly coming out. Fans are dispersing as the rain starts to fall here at Red Wilson Field. We're going to stay on for an extra moment or two to see if there's any final decisions on this game being just delayed or if we're going to call it final. If it were to go final, as the rain's really coming down now. Wow. Players rush to cover the tarp the mound, and home plate. Things are getting packed up in both dugouts, TJ. I wouldn't be shocked if they just call this one. Wow, out of nowhere, it is pouring. Doing some play-by-play of the rain out here today. It is really coming down.
Anyone tell you should be a meteorologist?
Bits of hail. Didn't I say that wasn't even a science earlier? I don't think.
You might have.
I said.
I must have not been listening.
Well, our local meteorologist, GM Steve Foucher, has been trying to keep us up to date on the bits of today. But wow, they are rushing the weights out there. And see, I can't predict the rain, but I can say what's going on right now. It's raining cats and dogs at Red Wilson Field, folks. Brian McLaughlin, TJ Mathewson here. Currently stands 5-2, top of the seventh. I'd be kind of surprised if we saw more baseball today from Red Wilson Field, however, just the way this weather is going. TJ, not the strongest showing from the Whitey offense. Actually, if we went final right now, it would be the fewest runs that Whitey has scored in a ball game to date this season. Definitely some frustration for them, but you have to think they were looking forward to maybe seeing somebody else aside from Ty Madden in this one out on the field and on the mound against them today in this deep lineup that just got held shut.
Yeah, it probably would have been the end of the night for Ty Madden anyways after the conclusion of this inning, having him thrown 3 1/3 innings. But yeah, they've really struggled with this Anglers pitching staff. They got off to a good start Tuesday in Chatham before that game got postponed due to fog. And here tonight, like much like the weather, they've been really on and off. They had good bottom of the second. The Red Sox were able to scratch across their only two runs, but otherwise have really struggled against these Chatham arms.
Whitey struck first back in the second inning against Mason Hazelwood. They scored two runs on a couple of hits. There was an error as well from Alex Terrell at first base that allowed one unearned run for YD, but it was all Chatham from there. They responded in the top of the third inning with two runs on three hits for the Anglers. A couple runs came across. Tyler Doan scored, as well as Caden Polkovich on the Spencer Torkelson 2-RBI double in the third inning back against Ian Seymour. Then Chatham was silent until the fifth, when a leadoff walk against Seymour would come around to score against Eric Tolman. Then the bases were loaded before Tolman was able to escape that frame, as we just saw another lightning blast here at Red Wilson Field. We'll see what goes from there.
Boy.
And there's some ominous thunder. This certainly came out of nowhere. Following that run in the fifth for Chatham, they took the lead then. A solo shot in the sixth that Brad Beasley almost robbed, but then couldn't quite bring it back. Chatham went up 4-2, and they just added another run in the top of the seventh before we started to see this downpour here in the seventh, TJ.
Yeah. It's been really unfortunate that just doesn't seem like the second week of the Cape League season has been meant to be played because the weather's not cooperating.
Hey, at least we got our game in here at Red Wilson Field. There have been a couple others that currently Chatham and YD delayed in the 7th, 5-2. Brewster's up 3-0 over Orleans. That also is being delayed. Bourne and Hyannis never got underway. That one was postponed. We have some currently in action. Falmouth up 4-0 over the first place Wareham Gateman in the West in the bottom of the first. And Katuit and Harwich are scoreless in the top of the third across the rest of the Cape League. After there were no games that got in yesterday, we're at least seeing some games. This one's going to be final, so we'll have a final score for you from Red Wilson today, TJ, no matter what the call is from Steve Foucher and company, the umpires, Tom Holliday and Scott Pickler from this one. At the moment, though, we're going to have a final score for you, which is as much as we can say, really, for these last week, really, like you said, the second week of this Cape League season.
It is better than rescheduling another game. That game on Wednesday in Chatham, very frustrating getting into the fourth inning and then unable to continue because of the fog and having to go all the way back and play that game right from the start again.
So it's 5-2, top of the seventh. TJ and I are going to step aside here. If we get any word on a final or if there will be a delay, we'll be sure to jump back on headsets here and let you know as soon as possible. As it stands, Chatham 5, YD 2. We're midway through the top of the seventh here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. back at Red Wilson Field inside the comfortable press box. The rain appears to have subsided, but they have called the game here at Red Wilson Field, dating back to the sixth inning. The seventh inning does not count. Chatham was in the middle of another rally. They scored once in the seventh, but that run will be taken off the board. So it's a 4-2 Chatham win final over YD here from Red Wilson Field. Brian McLaughlin with TJ Mathewson. TJ, it was Ty Madden who dominated on the mounds today for the Anglers and really turned the tide, I think, of this ball game. He gets the win and goes 3 1/3 on the mound and basically allowed nothing. Faced the minimum over 3 1/3 with a double play in there as well. He was just spectacular.
Yeah, the two times the Red Sox have gotten to face Hazelwood and Madden, their bats have just gone quiet. Those two has been able to figure out how to slow down this YD offense, would enter today leading the Cape League in runs, 7 runs per game. And, you know, Hazelwood was okay. Control was a little shaky. Served up the 2 runs to the Red Sox in the second inning. But, yeah, you mentioned Ty Madden was the guy today. He'll get the win for Chatham, going 3 1/3, no hits and no runs.
Ty Madden gets the win. It's his first of the season. He's 1-0 for the Anglers. Ian Seymour drops the decision for YD. He falls to 1-1 on the season. Chatham 4, YD 2. Final line for the Anglers. They scored 4 runs, 6 hits, 1 error. They left 4 aboard. The big hit for Chatham was an RBI double for Spencer Torkelson in the third, and then they were able to just punch across a run in the fifth inning. It was a sacrifice fly from Caden Polkovich that drove home Ben Ramirez to give them the lead, and then the final run came on a solo shot from Ramirez. He scored twice today in the sixth inning to straightaway center field, just a line drive off the glove of Brad Beasley, trying to rob the home run of Ramirez to put Chatham up 4-2. YD drops this one. They scored just 2 runs, 4 hits, no errors for the Red Sox. They left 4 aboard, all coming in the first 3 innings of this contest. TJ, the Red Sox return to action tomorrow from Falmouth at 3 o'clock for a doubleheader, hoping to take 2 from the Commodores, who currently sit at 3-3-1, 7 points on the year in the western side of the division. Whitey's going to drop to 4-3-1 after this one. What's the approach going into the doubleheader tomorrow?
Well, first, let's hope the field's dry down there in Falmouth.
True.
They're getting slammed with some rain today. And second, probably just get off to a little bit of a better start. I mean, the Red Sox did score first today, but the bats really fell quiet against the Commodores, who they're going to get to see for the first time tomorrow, as hopefully they'll get both games in tomorrow. We should cross our fingers here that no more weird weather sneaks up on us like it did today.
Whitey's played 15 official innings over the last 6 days, looking to double that with a doubleheader tomorrow against Falmouth. We'll have it for you here on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network. It's a final from Red Wilson Field, Chatham 4, YD 2. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Until then, this is Brian McLaughlin and TJ Mathewson on the Cape Cod Baseball League Network.